Today, we'll talk about flywheels. We got some here and we'll talk about it weight-wise. We've talked in the past about ventilation, flaps and how much air they pump. Now we're going to talk about flywheels in terms of weight and how you can choose them and with which engine. And even today, a special thanks to Massimiliano who bought our limited edition t-shirt and sent us a photo. Some preventive observations. So all engines, small or large, on motorbikes or cars or trucks, always have a flywheel. The flywheel has the task of homogenizing the motion of the crankshaft, especially at low revs. And other conditions being equal, it's always heavier the less the engine is fractionated, because on a single cylinder, since the bursts are more distant from each other, it needs a heavier flywheel. This is clear. And it clearly has inertia and therefore opposes acceleration when the engine wants to rev up. But slows down its deceleration when it wants to go down. It stores energy. It takes it when the engine is running and gives it back when the gas is released. And the influence of the flywheel is particularly noticeable in the homogeneity of operation at low revs. At high revs, it's felt less. However, a heavier flywheel reduces kickback and, in a sense, ultimately causes less energy to be dissipated in the latter. Therefore, a slightly heavier flywheel, within certain limits specific to each engine, increases the maximum power. Now, the choice of the flywheel is linked to the use of the vehicle, the course, the circuit. So, for example, speaking of vehicles for truck use, a slightly heavier flywheel will be advisable in circuits that have long straights. A lighter flywheel in a tight circuit where rapid acceleration is needed and reaching top speeds matters less. Now, again, because we have an eye on relative quantification and we want you to touch it firsthand, why with a light flywheel you feel that the vehicle gains a lot in short gears and not in long gears? So in a short time, a couple of seconds, how long it takes to switch to first a vehicle. Let's take a Vespa large with average tuning. It goes from 0 to about 40 per hour. Therefore, a mass of 200 kilos, Vespa plus the not too average rider, 200 kilos goes from 0 to 40 per hour. A flywheel of about 3 kilos, as is that of the PX, which has a diameter of 20 centimeters. To simplify, since the 3 kilograms are not uniformly distributed, we can assume a weight of half or a little more in short. Let's calculate 1.5 kilos with all at the maximum distance from the center, because clearly what matters is the mass that is distant from the center. Since the center has no inertia, since it doesn't move at all, the central point, if we consider that the flywheel weighs 1.5 kilos, all concentrated in the periphery, in the same short time in which the vehicle must reach 40 kilometers per hour, instead this 1.5 kilos here must be accelerated up to about 340 kilometers per hour if we consider 9,000 peak revolutions reached, compared to the vehicle that has 200 kilos pushed up to 40 kilometers per hour. 1.5 kilos at 340 kilometers per hour is not the same size, but still comparable. It's not another order of magnitude, we're not missing a zero, it's something much inferior, and in fact, is appreciated. Then we shift into second gear, the vehicle reaches 65 kilometers per hour, it takes longer, but the flywheel must always reach the same speed, so it affects less. In third gear also less, and in fourth almost not at all, in the end, because it becomes incomparable. On the contrary, when the maximum speed is approached, that little bit of extra power prevails that the heavy flywheel gives us, because it reduces losses due to operating irregularities. Before talking about how to choose the flywheel, let's see something important regarding the relationship between flywheel, weight and test bench results. I'm talking about those accelerated test benches that are the most widespread and those that sometimes bring out very different powers from one to the other, sometimes arousing controversy, quarrels even. For now, know that the benches that tell the truth, if well calibrated, are those that absorb power. That is, they transform it into heat through something that causes friction. There are various types, but still they are the ones. Those others that have the roller, which are accelerative, measure how long it takes for the engine, given the ratio which you set beforehand, to accelerate that mass to that certain number of revolutions. At that point, they go back to the power they need. But there is the flywheel, though. So what happens? When you do this, you need to know what you're doing. And also, you need to know what compares with what. The same engine, if we take it and test it with 1.8 kilos flywheel on the accelerator bench, and as many of you know, if they've seen it work, even with the fourth gear, it lasts as it does with the second, more or less on average. The flywheel has an influence, so if you try it with a lighter flywheel, the engine is more powerful. Try it with a heavy flywheel and the engine loses a horsepower. But then you test the Vespa on the road with the heavy flywheel and it runs better than that with the light flywheel for a long time. So the engine is more powerful because of the response from the speedometer. That's indisputable. For what reason? Because the flywheel interferes with the reading of the bench. Because the engine uses part of the power to accelerate the flywheel, given that it must reach a very significant peripheral speed. This is a very important aspect, which I hope Evelyn illustrated will help to resolve issues and quell sometimes useless controversies. Now, how do you choose the flywheel? That is, the flywheel is chosen in relation to the type of engine they use and also the character of the engine. A flywheel that is not too light is generally advantageous, unless there are specific needs. Sometimes on some vehicles it's essential to have a certain weight. For example, on the large Vespas, given that the clutch is on the crankshaft on the other side and is not on a conical coupling, but on a cylindrical coupling with a spring pin, if the flywheel becomes too light, that is, if with the 8 spring, of which the reinforced ones that have the ring around them are even worse, therefore the mass of the clutch increases, especially with those if the weight of the flywheel drops below 1.8 kilograms. It becomes dangerous because the spring pin of the clutch breaks, because the clutch begins to have an inertia, a bit smaller, comparable to that of the flywheel, and therefore begins to perform inertial functions for which it was not designed. That is, the coupling on the shaft was not designed, and so in the end it's meant to break. Among other things, here too, now we are generally speaking about the weight of the flywheel, but we need to see where this weight is. For example, this flywheel here is an Elestart without the ring nut. This flywheel weighs several hundred grams less than those of the first PX, and I believe there are differences of 3 or 400 grams. However, the inertia is similar because the steel ferrule is on the periphery. So there is a part of the weight concentrated on the extreme periphery, and the ring rotates extremely fast because the peripheral speed is the maximum possible. So talking about weight, you have to check. There are the 2.5 kilograms Parmacate ignitions with a machine flywheel, which yes, weigh 2.5, but have less inertia than this because the weight is more towards the center. Now, as far as the Vespa's model is concerned, the general argument is equally valid there too. The freedom of choice is greater because the clutch is mounted in a more advantageous point, i.e. after the first reduction. So the crankshaft doesn't have something that has significant inertia on the other side. The pinion is very small, it's negligible, but that can break due to kickbacks if the flexible coupling is missing. Certainly not because it has inertia, because compared to that of the lighter flywheel, it's always irrelevant. Of course, Piaggio and the Vespa's model with the 125 engines exaggerate, because the flywheel of the ET3 really had an exaggerated weight. That's too much. And among other things, in fact, Piaggio itself has went back to its steps, and I have put them here to show you. This is an ET3 flywheel. Here you go, look at the other edge. It's full, so it's the most relevant part for the flywheel's inertia. This here is a PXXL 125 ETS flywheel. You can see that there isn't that full edge. It's a big difference, and indeed it's true, because it was just too much. However, on performance engines, that is say a 130 or something like that, this is the HP flywheel. Yeah, the HP here, this one is already very light. Without the ring nut, it's really absurd mounted, because it's too little. In the end, a very light flywheel can give satisfaction to the rev aficionados. Revving in neutral, you may feel the engine very ready, but on the road it never pays off. In first gear and the first acceleration, but after that it's an effect that wears off immediately. As I said in the beginning, all vehicles have a flywheel, racing or otherwise. We've given the example of Vespas because I have this available. For example, on go-karts that are powered by very advanced engine, albeit underpowered by regulation, there too is the flywheel, which is mainly, with great advantage, incorporated in crankshaft. Because at ignition there is practically no flywheel, there is a very small rotor only for the sensor signal. And the mass of the flywheel, even if it's not exaggerated, however, it's all concentrated in the shaft, and it's the best flywheel mass, because it's the one that really reduces those kickbacks due to the fact that the maximum burst pressure is reached about 5 degrees after the top dead center. And therefore, when the connecting rod is still very vertical. At that moment, only a very heavy crankshaft can oppose the tendency to translate, impressed by the connecting rod in favor of rotation. While a very light shaft will transmit more consistent kickback to the main bearings, essentially this is it, the only reason why a heavy flywheel on a light shaft doesn't give absolutely the same results as a light flywheel on a heavy shaft. Much better the second thing. Other vehicles, cars, even those that race on the track, but also in very distant years. In short, there were those who went around with series derived machines with different flywheels for each circuit to have the right ratio between the engine's availability to accelerate on short distances and greater power at high regimes. Even on cars, of course, except for small jobs, we try not to take weight off the crankshaft, always to a small extent. And instead of acting on the flywheel, if and when necessary, among other things with great care, because the flywheel on cars also acts as a stop for the clutch, so it also has another task. Heavy vehicles that have slow diesel engines have very heavy flywheels. even heavier in proportion, because the more the engine has an arc of use shifted towards low revs, the more advantageous it is to have a baby flywheel that homogenizes its operations. So, this is also a criterion. It's generally the case, the more power the engine delivers at low revs, the heavier the flywheel. The opposite if the engine is devoted to very high revs. If you like this video, leave a thumbs up and share it with your friends. Remember, White Pine Racing is not a workshop, but an amateur sport association that works on engines only for sport purposes and only for its associates.